So I tried to figure out if I could fit any more words in this title, you know. So last year I was talking on swarming and AI bots, and there's quite a bit that's happened in this area. And so, like she said, my name's Tom Caldwell. I run this company called League of AI, but I've my background includes working at Microsoft. I've been in security products and networking most of my career. I spent 11 years as the director of engineering at Cisco Systems. And then I've been an entrepreneur and started a number of successful startups, from a coffee shop idea to a successful exit. So today, you know, I guess over the years, I have to admit, AI and machine learning has been one of the most exciting things that I found in my career as a computer scientist, right? And so we're going to talk a bit about all of this today. So we're going to talk AI bots. I'm going to focus a lot on swarming. And then just recently, I've been doing consulting for a robotics company. And just the whole idea of robots coming into our lives and part of our society and sort of offsetting the human capability is something that really interests me. And so we'll get started. And so what I wanted to start out with first is, you know, will robots be top of mind for parents? Because we all have kids in school, and school safety is top of mind. And now we're putting humans, security officers, in the schools and trying to make them safer that way. Now, I happen to like dogs, but I got a little dog up there in the upper right-hand corner. Where'd it go? My dog's missing. Anyway, it must be a different set of slides. Anyway, I had a police dog up in my latest slides. And, you know, police dogs are interesting because you don't see them patrolling all by themselves out on the streets. You know, they're with a trainer. They're with someone, a human, right? But they have extra capabilities, such as sniffing bombs out and sniffing drugs, and their sense of smell is a lot better than a human, right? So we augment the human capability. Well, I think we're going to see, and I've even talked to the LA Police Department about robots in schools, because, you know, not only it's a higher quality of safety, but they wouldn't be roaming all by themselves around a school. They'd be partnered with a security guard, sort of like a police dog would. But I think of a robot as a mobile pod of IoT sensors, right? So you can have not only shot detection, you can hear screaming. Robots can detect, see things, objects of interest. They can confront a shooter very safely compared to a human. And so there's a lot of different scenarios I'm starting to run into where robots augmenting the human makes a lot of sense in a lot of different verticals. And so at the end, I have this human machine swarming, you know, at the end. But if you think of swarming, now, if we go to the next slide, I don't know if you've ever seen like a starling murmuration. They're supposed to be, you know, quite a thing to capture. But just like ants or bees, swarms of bees and armies of ants, you know, we've always been interested in how did these entities or biological creatures collaborate, cooperate, and reach consensus, right? It's been a mystery, right? And so someday you may actually look up at the sky and see a swarm of bots, maybe even like nanobots, right? And so, you know, some people go, well, how do you sort of put together this swarming concept, right? Well, if you think of humans, you know, when we build tall buildings or even homes, we swarm. We have specialists. We have electricians, plumbers, roofers, framers. They all know their job, and the architect sort of helps coordinate them. But we all know how to build houses exceptionally well. And again, these swarms of humans, they collaborate, cooperate, and they reach consensus on how to do a mission or something like that. Now, if we start looking at swarming as a service, you know, again, I spoke on swarms and AI bots last year at RSA, and there's actually been so much work going on just in the last year around swarming, right? And so these researchers in Hong Kong have found that they created these swarms of clusters of nanobots. And these swarms can detect, you know, all sorts of different things. In fact, Fortinet predicted a number of emerging threats around these, they call them swarm bots. And they have the capabilities now to, they can pre-program the swarms that use machine learning to break into a device or network. Swarms can provide what they call AI fuzzing to detect zero-day exploits. Swarms can be designed or are designed to move laterally across the network, across the attack surfaces, right? And then swarm can evade detection or collect exfiltration data targets. And swarms are also able to do data poisoning, right? So if you have a machine learning algorithm and you've trained your model, then you can actually feed bad data into it and make the model not behave correctly or less accurately. So they know how to do that now also. And they're designed to cross the cyber physical device divide to take control of a target's physical as well as cyber resource and capabilities. So this idea that it's just not cyber anymore, that there's a physical side coming, and I like to think of there's a robot side too, right? A sense of IoT pods that that you can add to your capabilities. But innovation is really moving at quite a fast pace. Now, I wanted to mention this startup, Unanimous AI. They've been around for a while, but they've done a really good job at predicting things, right? And that's what we all want, predictive analytics or predictive machine learning to see into the future, right? And so they've been able to predict, like, the last 3 years Oscar winners. They were able to predict the Kentucky Derby Superfecta, the top four winners in order. So they've been able to, again, use human swarming, and this is purely with humans. It's almost like a big voting machine. But to be able to capture human opinion and then be able to have very accurate predictions. And they call themselves swarming. Also in the last year, I've seen Radhika Nagpal, if I say it right. She's a researcher at Harvard, and she's captured and amazed by, you know, biological insects, you know, ants building big homes and mounds and bees working together. And so if you look on YouTube, she has some very interesting videos around her robots that actually, they construct buildings and they work together as a swarm. You know, they collaborate, they cooperate, they reach consensus around building a mission on creating this building. And they're pretty advanced robots, but again, everyone's focused on this idea of swarming, right? Now, if we look at the evolution of robots, you know, they've been around for a while. We know them well in manufacturing. But now, actually, robots can assist with brain surgery. So again, we're getting more use cases around where a robot or a pod of sensors can assist a human being in doing a much better job at some kind of focused specialty, right? Now let's get back to sort of the robot side of things. You know, right now it's easy to get off the shelf TensorFlow and deep learning, machine learning models where you don't have to be a mathematician or write them from scratch anymore. Like, I actually had a startup where we had to write machine learning from scratch. And it's not easy, it's not trivial. But now with TensorFlow and MXNet and all the packages out there, it's fairly easy to have robots to train them to identify objects of interest, whether it's a backpack by the door, what type of automobile it is. They're using it in marketing now to be able to detect all sorts of different types of objects of interest that you want to train these models on, right? And they also have natural language processing. That's advanced quite a bit. We all have either talked to Siri or Alexa or, you know, different types we talk to software. And I think that's pretty cool. It used to be, in the old days, we had these user interfaces, these screens, and you'd stare at them all day, especially if you were in cybersecurity, right? You'd be in your SOC and you'd have all these dark screens up. Well, now we can talk to our software, it can see things. And on the bottom there, I have some friends of mine that started this company in San Diego, where I'm from, called WowYow, right? And they started out in marketing, but they observe objects of interest, right? So I put them to a test, and I attached it to a robot, a video camera, and I went through the downstairs parking lot of where I live, it's multi-floor, And at the end, it was able to identify all the makes and models of the cars and all the license plates and take a complete inventory of what was in that parking lot. And you know, a lot of humans do that kind of task, and we're not here to put humans out of jobs, but usually they'll walk through with a clipboard on a private parking lot and take down license plates and see who's supposed to be there and who's not, right? That's a very inefficient human task where we could easily replace that with robots. And again, I don't think they're off wandering all by themselves. They usually have a human counterpart or a human assistant that goes along with it. Now, getting back a little bit to swarming algorithms, you know, people have started down this road of building these algorithms, thinking about more geospatial vectors, right? And so whether it's a collision avoidance or flocking algorithms or ant colony optimization, they're thinking about bots, robots, and how they can actually, coordinate physically. But if you look at a vector has two aspects to it. It has a heading and a velocity, right? And so, I drive to Carlsbad every day, and I go from southern San Diego to Carlsbad. So my heading's north every day, and I travel about 55 miles per hour. And so that's, you could say that's a driving behavior, but it's represented as a vector, right? Now, one day I may go north, but only travel at 25 miles an hour. And then you go, well, that's odd. That's anomalistic behavior, right? Or I may travel 55 miles an hour, but head a different direction, right? Again, that's sort of odd. Why is Tom acting, why is his behavior acting in an odd way, an anomaly? And so when we start applying these vectors, we can start thinking of them as, they can represent cognitive behaviors and discovered opinions. I had a company that we looked for anomalies on the network. And so what we would do is cluster a set of features, whether it's size of packets, number of packets transmitted from one IP to another. And again, you can actually represent that in a vector through machine learning modeling. And then once you get it into a vector, then you can start learning, good behaviors, bad behaviors, odd behaviors. And a lot of the industry, especially in cybersecurity, especially with all the polymorphic malware, we have to use anomaly detection now to sort of weed out these strange behaviors and then try to figure out if they're high risk or low risk or what our exposure is and go down those lines. And then a friend of mine, Dr. Hossein Aslambolchi, he used to be CTO of AT&T, he goes, Tom, I think blockchain could be used in the future around this centralized sharing and voting and swarm. So there's still a lot of work. It's very much in the infancy of this. Now, I wanted to give you some examples. Maybe some of you saw in the Winter Olympics the 1,200 drones that Intel used to do fancy things in the air. Again, very a physical aspect of swarming. And then there's some researchers at the Institute of Lisbon that they created a sea of robots, and they actually have these little boats, and they all act as a swarm. In fact, you can give them a mission, and if you take one out, they'll fill in for each other. So they're collaborating, coordinating, and they're reaching consensus around these missions that they give them. So a lot of people are starting to do work here. How many people have heard of Metasploit? Okay, security conference. How many people have heard of Deep Exploit? Okay, a few. Well, they're taking deep learning now, and they're applying it to Metasploit for pen testing. And so now you have these deep learning algorithms that are now trying to figure out how to break into something, pen testing, supposedly for the good guys, right? And the thing is that the training of these neural networks, they take quite a while to train, and they do different types of, recurrent training to accomplish this, right? But how do they make it so fast? They're starting to use swarming techniques, a distributed set of agents to train off of. And they're figuring out how to create these swarms to be able to figure out how to penetrate using Metasploit or deep learning algorithms around Metasploit much faster. And so my friends tell me that at DEF CON this year, they'll probably be using this form of swarming to protect DEF CON. But that's, right now, that's hearsay. But I find it very interesting that this whole idea of swarming is taking off in a lot of different areas. Give me a second here. So let's get back to the cybersecurity and AI bots. Now, you know, bots, they're fast becoming part of our society, right? We see chat bots all over the place. They're on our web pages. You call them up for support. You're not talking to a human being. You're talking to these chat bots, and they're calling them cognitive, you know, it's cognitive AI, that where they're learning to, like they can even infer how you're feeling in the tone of your voice now, these chat bots, and be able to start having inferences on what, how to take you in a conversation to qualify you to get you to an insurance agent or whatever they're trying to do, right? And so cyber criminals, they're investing in them also, right? So they, you know, we've seen the Nachi worm a while back and the Mirai botnets. And so we just caught in our red lab, the Eternal Blue exploit has been merged with the Mirai botnet. And we saw that in action. So we're seeing a lot of these exploits starting to get put together and add machine learning into them to make them a lot more powerful. Now, in my mind, an AI bot capability is, you know, I've been talking about machine learning, and cyber intelligence is the data that you give it. It can do the behavioral analysis. The ontology part is it knows the difference between a iPhone watch, a laptop, a server, a router. It knows the ontology of things, so it can apply different attack vectors to the different types of devices and their operating system and their known defects. It understands entity state. And so you're seeing a lot of state machines, especially with graph link databases, are starting to be used to show how an entity, whether it's a user or a device, can go from one state, especially in cybersecurity, to another state. So, you know, keeping it simple, red, yellow, green, right? It's either green, meaning it's safe, I don't think it's infected. Yellow, meaning it might have anomalistic behavior, and it might be associated with risk and the exposure of your company. And then red, we definitely know it's infected. And so this whole idea of security posture or keeping track of state, and then transitional state changes, you know, something that is becoming very popular. And then also, people just don't want detection, you know, do something about it. So orchestration and even deception tactics may be something that people are adding now to their security capabilities. Now, what I'm seeing a lot is Jupyter Notebooks. I don't know if you've ever used a Jupyter Notebook if you're in machine learning, but you know, Netflix actually is operationalizing their Jupyter Notebooks, and they're able to schedule them, trigger them, you know, fire them off. And so now they're just having these big libraries of Jupyter Notebooks that they can go execute. Now, a Jupyter Notebook in the orchestration of deception tactics, it could be a validation and automate a security engineer going out and checking on five different things to make sure he's not working on a false positive, right? It could also be a Jupyter Notebook to go off and close a port on a firewall or take some action, right? So they're becoming very powerful in this whole idea of scheduling Jupyter Notebooks or triggering them or managing them in your operations. It's becoming very popular. And AI bots, you know, what do you think of their pieces of software? They can live inside of a robots or drones or be virtual. They can be resident on the edge. In fact, a lot of NVIDIA TXT2 boards are starting to get deployed at the edge in robots. You know, they run on a Raspberry Pi. Or they could be the cognitive engine in a sim, a new age sim. So this whole idea of cognitive machine learning is getting more popular now. And you know, one of the things I'm thinking about the new age SOC, but we need to automate mundane tasks, right? Because too many security analysts are checking too many events, and it's just very time consuming, inefficient. We also need visualization tools which connect the dots. So graph link databases, like I said, are getting much more popular at sort of mapping out the, connecting the dots on an incident or a potential breach. And then we need to combine the strengths of humans and machines. We need this human in the loop, this human-machine interaction, call it swarming if you want. And we need to create a unified workflow and a workspace. But we need to use the machines to model how the attackers operate and then automate the way analysts investigate and hopefully come together with a lot much smarter security operations center. Now, you'll start hearing these words, cognitive engines or cognitive AI bots, I call them. You know, IBM first brought cognitive computing to life with Watson, and they've been using that word quite a bit, but now a lot of other vendors are also using the word cognitive. And so, you know, you want to be able to have it, be able to have some sort of intuition like a human to help solve problems. You know, doesn't need to solve all the problems, but you know, some of my friends give me a hard time because I call this sort of an oracle, right? And they go, no, that's the name of a company. I go, no, an oracle is able to look in the past, analyze the present, and predict the future, right? And so these time series databases like InfluxDB and things like that are becoming very popular to put events over a time series and then be able to start, you know, trying to look at the behavioral changes and then be able to look at the past, present, and future and then be able to infer the intent. You know, what is the bad actor after? You know, are they here to steal money? Are they here to disrupt something? You know, and then what's the content to be able to create a storyline, right? And so my friends and I have been sort of working on this whole cognitive engine concept, and we believe that with human-machine interaction, that you can start putting together this storyline. You know, the machine can go, well, I found four anomalies. Do you think they're related to each other? Human could go, those three I bet are, but that one maybe isn't. But that kind of interaction can speed up the whole process of detecting a breach and figuring out what they're after, and then being able to sort of solve the problem. So, you know, this slide, I was trying to take the conversation up a little bit, because we're all dealing with events in our SOCs and security operation systems. And these cognitive engines are really trying to take this, you know, I get 5 million stream of events a day. You know, some of the big retailers and such, they're overrun by events, right? And so I think these cognitive engines can actually help try to sort of piece out, you know, the exposure, again, your risk profiles, and trying to figure out very quickly, what are the bad actors after? What's their intent? What's their context, right? I mean, what resources do you have that can be exploited by others, right? So if we can actually get out of the weeds of analyzing just events and be able to have cognitive help of machines being able to help us figure this out then quicker, then I think this could be a very powerful technology. And I think you're going to see these cognitive engines start to merge in the market, a layer above the event management, you know, layer to help put the pieces together faster. So what I want to do today is I'm going to summarize, you know, these cognitive AI bots, they're here today. They can live in the cloud, in a robot, on the edge. You can chat with humans, you know, they can talk to you. Your software can talk to you. And we'll have the cognitive engines, the brains, to understand these event streams of, again, sort of the oracle idea, past, present, and predictive future. And that's what a lot of, you know, when I get some AI contracts every once in a while, and customers come to me and they go, I don't know what AI is, but it's, but I know I need it, right? And what I want out of it is to predict the future. I want to know when bad things are coming at me, you know, in a more proactive manner instead of reactive, right? And we've all heard that. And so I think that's where these cognitive engines and some of these new machine learning predictive capabilities can be added into our security frameworks. And then they can see, right? They can have the vision through cameras to detect objects of risk. And they can listen through microphones for gunshots or screams. And again, when you think about your cybersecurity of your office, and then you think about your physical security of your office, they will start blending together a bit, and we can start integrating them, you know. And I think about, for instance, you know, a video camera, right? I assume there's one up here on the screen, but physical security cameras, you know, well, the facilities manager probably installed them or helped install them, right? But they're an IT function also, because they stream video to a video application that maybe some security guard watches, right? But they're a SecOps problem too, because like the Mirai botnet, that's the first thing they go after is video cameras, because no one upgrades the software. They're sort of forgotten on the ceiling. And so whose problem are they? Facilities, IT, SecOps? Most people, I ask this quite a bit, and most people go, well, I'm not sure, you know? So I think on IoT, especially as we start integrating with more of these IoT applications, physical security with cybersecurity, then we'll start looking again at the, you know, what do we got connected to the network, and how can we share the ownership and use cognitive AI and machine learning and swarming to help solve that. So this is the last slide, applying cyber and physical dimensions to security. They all want us to have what can I take home with me, and how can I apply this to myself, right? And so, you know, think about data. It all starts with data. If you got bad data, then you can't do anything else, because I don't care how smart cognitive machine learning models you have. You really have to have good data, which we call cyber intelligence, right? That's the data source. And it could be from a log, virtually, and we know and love log management, right? Or it could be from an IoT camera, right? Noticing something that could be cyber-related in the physical world. And I identify the use cases where having physical intelligence would make your security framework smarter. You know, and I guess it depends on which vertical you're around, but I think light industry, as we call it, which we know we all have a building and we're all putting things on buildings and IoT devices, you know, excuse me, take a look at that. And then, like I said, get your facilities teams to partner with you on identifying IoT devices that are just left out there, sort of forgotten, and put in a program where you can actually share between facilities, IT, and SecOps the ability to lifecycle manage that IoT device, secure it, and not make it part of a threat landscape, right? And then identify and track future robotic capabilities that help integrate or swarm your security AI tools and staff in a safer, smarter security posture. So these are my takeaways today. And the last thing I'm gonna leave you with is robots are part of our society. I see them creeping up all over the place. In fact, there's one named Popper, I think, down on the show floor that you can go talk to. But they're showing up in every vertical, and I don't think they should be brought to market without some integration with the cybersecurity world, right? I think if we're gonna use them for physical security, then we should have a common security framework to embrace them with. So I probably rushed through the slides a little bit too quickly, but I'll take any questions if you have any. So edge computing, he said, where do you see edge computing coming in with swarming? And you know, I think on the edge, I know that, like, for instance, the NVIDIA TXT2 board is gonna be a popular edge device, right? And you really have to have a lot of the machine learning done down at the on the edge level. So I think I think it's a must have. And then on the swarming side, I've seen robots now and their vendors starting to look at how they swarm. You know, what is the, a lot of it's still in a physical way, but so you could have a team of robots, you know, roaming around. But I think you know, you still have a cloud back end, but the edge is very important, I think, for intelligence-wise and to share information. Now, whether you have a little mesh and how you communicate, some of that still has to be worked out. Does that answer your question? Yeah. Any other questions? All right, well, I thank you for attending, and I hope it was informational. The slides will be posted up on the internet for you to see, including the audio. And so thank you very much. I appreciate your presence.